leveraging Survey 123. So you guys all enjoy, and we're going to have lunch following in the back there. So without any other questions, Justin.
Okay, so I'm going to be talking about how you can kind of use Survey 123 and Word to come up with good reporting tools. And a little bit to begin with, Survey 123 is really just a great tool for customized workflows, data collection. It's real simple to work with. It's easy for the public to use. They get something similar to a SurveyMonkey, so they really don't need to know what they're doing. And you can also capture location information, and it works on any device, so you don't have to have any applications. It can, and it actually improves the accuracy of the GPS location, but it's not needed. And you don't really even need to know geodatabase design or anything like that. It's creating it for you. So what I did was I started off with a paper form. So this is the New York State DOT outfall inspection form. So pretty straightforward. Go through it. You fill out the information. There's a box in there for latitude, longitude, and stuff like that. So I converted it to Survey 123. So this is a process, just because this form, I think, is 7 pages, and trying to convert it just takes a while. But once it's in there, it's real easy. So you just start off with going to the website, Survey 123, and you need to have a named user account for Esri. So if you already have an organization, odds are you have some named accounts, and you can just work with it. And you just go in and you create your survey. And I'm just going to talk about the web designer version for the survey. Survey 123 Connect allows you to use Excel forms. And there's actually a lot more functionality within that Excel form that you can do. You can throw in related tables and do other things that you can't do with the web designer. But it's a bit of a challenge to kind of put it together. And if you need to spin up something quickly, it's very easy to go along with the web designer. So you just click create new survey, and then fill out the information, which will be the name and what keywords, so it can be looked up later. Then you just go through and create your survey. It has preset survey boxes, so it has single line text. You can do the single choice, so you can do radio buttons, drop downs. It will do a date. You can automatically tell it to submit on, to put the date as being the submitting date or a different date. If you want people to put in when they observed it versus when they reported it, you can. You can use everything pretty much more than one time, with the exception of the location, which is only a single point. So that's one of the limitations of Survey 123. It is a point collection tool. And also image. They are working on making it so you can upload more than one image, but right now it's a little tricky on uploading more than one image. But what's nice is you can have people take a picture of something and you have that in your database. The other thing is you can add in filters. And these filters allow you to skip questions and have different questions pop up for the people. So they're real simple. You can say on a yes-no question or a single choice, a radio button, if they pick this particular value, show these values. So then it will kind of grow and change depending on how people need it. So for outfall inspection, one of the big boxes says, is flow present? If no, skip to page 4. So what I did was hit no, and none of the yes answer boxes even appear. So you can just, it skips you right to it. So you don't even need to know of that. It's automatically doing it for you. So that's what that will look like. So up top, it tells you what questions are associated with that particular question. So question 73, 70, 67, 64, and 61. If yes, then answer these, open up these other boxes. And those are tied later on. that if you answer that box, more boxes answer afterwards. So you have a lot more information that's possible. So here's some of the other boxes and choices that you have. So single choice, you could just do yes, no. And the other nice thing with Survey 123 that you don't get with a lot of other GIS collection tools is this other button. And you can click other and let the people actually type in the answer. With collector, other is, you can have an other, but then you have to have a second box for what does other mean. But this has it built into it. You can do multiple choice, so you could have check boxes and they can just go through and add them in. The only catch with multiple choice is you, once it's built and published, you cannot delete an answer, you can only add to it. Because what it's doing in the background is creating a domain for the geodatabase. And if you change the background geodatabase domain, if you look at it, it says choice one is equal to sewage. So if you change that, choice one is always going to be sewage. It's just a matter of adding to it. But if you try to change choice one to something else, everything that was sewage is now something different. So you need to kind of keep that in mind. You can also do things such as ratings. So you can do a 1 to 3, 1 to 5, you know, star ratings. I used to do this for a lunch map. So the office could go through, post what places they like to go to lunch, what did they rate it, how expensive is it, and so everybody could kind of have this growing, living map to kind of share people as, you know, get interns and stuff like that. So that one's just kind of a fun way, but also it's a pretty good way to kind of work with some of the data. So then you go through and spend a lot of time doing each question on the original form. And then you get something that looks similar to this. You don't have a lot of choices on how to make it look. There is the appearance where it has some nice seams, but the seams are all made by Etherate. So you have a green, a blue, and then you have some nice mountain landscapes. But you really don't have anything beyond that. And this will, how it will look basically, depending on what you're working with. And then you can go through and publish it. So when you publish the survey, there's a button at the bottom that says publish. And it will automatically lock in some of the choices and have it ready to go, and anybody can use it. It is ready to collect data at that point. You can't really do a test publish, but what you can do is once you have it and you're happy with it and you publish it, you can test it, look at it, and then delete the results, and then add in the final results into it. And that's all done through ArcGIS's online backend. The other thing that it does is you have a preview button. And the preview allows you to see how it will look in different devices. So you can look at it on a computer screen, which for the most part it's going to look pretty good. Or you can have it look like it's on a phone. And this is how it does a pretty good job. The biggest drawback for this is the rating. So when you do like a 5-star rating, you have 3 stars on the top line and you might have 2 stars on the bottom. And unfortunately, there is no way to kind of play with that beyond. And same thing with a 10-star and stuff like that. So that's the only things that kind of get cut off. But it does word wrap nicely otherwise. And then the other way is on a tablet. And it works both in landscape and portrait. So the other thing, once you have it published, you can choose to share it out. And there are multiple ways to share it out. So you have your standard group sharing that you're familiar with ArcGIS Online, where you can share it to a particular group. You can share it with your organization. Or you can share it with everybody. And the nice thing with Survey123 is it doesn't require a named user. So when you share it with everybody, if you send them a link, or it even will generate a QR code, you can then open up that application on any device and let people insert data. You can also tell it that you require it to run in its own native application, or you can just tell it to run in a web browser. And the nice thing with that is the application can use higher accuracy GPSs associated with the phone. So if you have a Bluetooth, Trimble, or something else, you can have that GPS location populating the survey location. But if you're just doing and having people report something that's in the community, the accuracy may not be as important, so you can just have it do browser-based location. Which sometimes is great, sometimes it's flaky, but the map allows you to manually put the point down too. So if they click on it and they realize that it's showing them in Brighton when they're reporting something in the middle of Blackfeet Park, they can manually go in and update that location. And a lot of times that happens, especially on the browser, because it's basing it on the Wi-Fi location. So if you're doing a, it doesn't get a live feed from the device that it's GPS. Or if you're doing it from home, it's going to do it on your home address. Once the data is published, you can then go through, you can look at the reporting. It does some nice things on some of the data analyzing. It has a geography table, and it has a summary table that if you get more than 20 results in it, will give you a nice word cloud of all of the different results if you have an open-ended question. And then it will give you graphs and other things by question, so you can actually see how the data is playing out. So I only did 3 points when I did this demo. So you can see it actually will tell you how many people are reporting per day, how many reports you're getting. So if you're doing a public information, you can see certain days being higher or lower, and you can actually look at the trends of people using the application. So if you're doing like a parks application and having people say, these are issues on the trail, you could see on the weekends possibly what people are using it because they're out. So here's an example of kind of how some of the analytical tools, it kind of shows you, different words that are being used. And this is where you'd see word clouds start populating after 20 results. Otherwise, it gives you the word and the number of times it's used. And when it does word cloud, it actually makes the words larger if people use it more, and smaller if people don't use it as much. And then it gives you the option to see the data location-based as well as the attribute table. So pretty straightforward. It's generating this, and it's automatically giving you a base map, so you don't even need to set up a web map in the application for it. It does have the options in the bottom that you can create a map viewer, so you can create a web application for it, and then you can throw in your own custom layers into it. But by default, it's just giving you whatever Esri's default base map is for your organization as the default view for the data. You also can download the data. And downloading the data, sometimes it's very tricky because it's seems to be pretty straightforward with CSV, Excel, KML, shapefile, and FileG database. But not everything plays with that domain properly. And so what I end up doing a lot of times is I download the FileG database because that's going to be the raw data. Otherwise, if you download the Excel, you might sometimes will run into an issue where instead of getting a yes, no, it's option one, option two. And then you have to go back and clean it up. But in the geodatabase, it knows that it's correct. Supposedly, in the December update for Survey123, this has been fixed, but I'm still on the edge of caution, at least for a little bit. So once you have the Jira database, I actually run it through IJS Pro, and I convert the table from the Jira database back to Excel, because there are two checkboxes that allow me to load the aliases and load the domains into the Excel. And so that way, I know it's going to be the correct data coming into the Excel file that I then use for the mail merge report that I'm building. And but like I said, sometimes it works in the ArcGIS Online, sometimes it doesn't. The other thing is, you sometimes don't need to actually download the data. You can just run it right from your ArcGIS portal instance, running it right from the original data source. And then you can just pull it live. So that's another option. Sometimes it works really well, sometimes it just says cannot access it, and then you go back, download it, and start over. So for Word, what I do is I create take the template and basically delete any of the boxes that were fillable and replace it with the same field name from the attribute table. So using mail merge, what I do is I load the data and I convert it fairly easy, straightforward. And you might have to reconstruct if you're working with a paper form. Yeah, you might have to spend time making it into a nice Word document. And so, like I said, it was a fillable form, so I didn't have a lot of work to do. All I had to do was basically insert the corresponding fields into it. So I basically decided to use Microsoft's mail merge technique because it's simple, it works, and if you have a lot of data, it handles it very nicely. So you load the Excel as the where you get your mailing information from, and you go through and say insert what field, and so you just go through and you pick your fields and where they belong. And and you just kind of go along and do it. Then you can go through and there's an option to look at, you can finish it, you can preview the data. And when you hit preview, it's going to actually fill out the form with your Excel data. And then you can just go through, if it looks good, hit finish. You can also individually edit the different form pages. So if somebody didn't capitalize a letter on something and you want it to be clean, you can go through and change each one manually if you want. The other option is you could always go into the Excel and do the formatting and then just run it again and have it work. And then you can just use it, and when you hit print, you get 50 copies or however many copies of the report, but each one updated for that particular data set. So fairly easy to do, and it just, it works very smoothly, and what used to take, you know, a couple hours manually filling out each individual report page now is done in a couple seconds. And then also, everything does have a location, so you can also have your map, and you can sort into any map template that you want to use. So if you have a project and looking at outfalls in your location, and you can say these are the ones that have been inspected, and you could have a and show that. Also, in the December ArcGIS Online update, they actually started putting in a reporting tool, which works very similar to the mail merge. It still says beta, so sometimes it means it's good, sometimes it's flaky, but it is there. And it works very similar. You upload a Word document, and when you're working with it, it actually will show you what question and what the original field name is for each question. And you just paste that tag into the location that you would have the mail merge. And when you hit generate report, it's doing the same exact process. The only thing is, you don't have the control of having the ability to edit individual records if you need to and stuff like that. But it does have that ability right now, but it wasn't there before the December program. So it's something that they are working on improving and making it more friendly. So with that, I'll end. Any questions?
So for either of those options, what about pictures that you take? Do those get included in the reports?
Unfortunately, not yet. I haven't found an easy way other than some Python scripting to extract the pictures out of the Geo database and then using some really weird scripting languages to kind of rename each photo to match the name of the report. So that gets a little tricky, but it's not possible to embed it just yet.
How did you get the original paper form in a format that...
I kept looking online for a good form example, and that was already available online.
No, but so with that, how did you make the mail merge push that information into that form, into that format? Is it a Word document?
Yep, that was a Word document originally. I downloaded it off the state's website.
And you pull that Word document up into Survey 123.
I did it both ways.
Build your template from the document.
Yeah.
Okay.
I had to sit there, copy paste each question.
Okay.
And then manually load each option. So that took a little bit of time, but once you have it, it's set. You don't have to go back and redo it.
And that puts it out into the form, into the same form. I miss how that happens. How it gets back onto the same form and the same form.
Yeah, it goes back in the same form by doing the mail merge. So you add in the field that corresponds to the question.
So you created this Survey 123 template out of the original Word document.
Mm-hmm.
And when you push it back in, you're going to Survey 123.
And then taking the Survey 123 and bringing it back into the Word document.
I see.
Questions. Offline mode, is that capable in either one of those, or do you have to have an internet connection?
You can do offline. Survey 123 does do it very nicely, especially in the app. I don't think it does it well in the web browser, but it says it should be able to. I just have not tried it. I always use the app. But I use the app offline all the time.
What if you already have the points and you want to go back to inspect them?
I would do collected. Esri says using the Excel form, there's a methodology that will work with it through Workforce as well. I have not figured out how to make it work yet, but Esri says it is possible.
What was the other option that you mentioned in addition to using Web Designer? What was the other methodology?
It's called XLS Forms.
XLS Forms.
Yeah, and it's using, there's an add-on for the download called Survey 123 Connect, and that basically will connect the XLS form to the Survey 123 to upload it into your organization.
That's a follow-up. When would you, what type of situation would you go through that option instead of using the web-based? So this is kind of quick and...
It's quick and easy. The other way, you have a lot more options if you want to have a lot more control on what's happening. So you're not just limited to the default options. You can actually put in more stuff.
So you could actually get to more of the nitty-gritty domain level like you do it.
Yeah.
So you're using it for like public use. Is there a way for it to like notify you when someone fills out the survey?
Not yet. I haven't seen that. You could write a script basically that checks each day and if count is greater than the count from the day before, send an email. That is possible through Python, but there isn't a direct way. So I have one and I just look at it each day and see. When you open up Survey 123, it tells you how many results you have. And if you notice that the result is now 19 or 20 instead of what it was, you know, you got some responses. That's one thing I think they are working on as well. And But yeah, they don't have it just yet. But it's something Python will do it very easily.
So it's compatible with Apple and Android?
Yep, it actually works also on Windows too. And yeah, it works on any of the mobile devices, and actually the desktop apps for both Apple and Windows as well. I don't think there is a Linux one, but it still would work on a web browser on Linux.
One more for you, Justin. By default, do other users see everyone else's surveys, or does each user only see their own stuff?
By default, you only see your own stuff unless it's shared to the organization or to the group. And even at that, you don't see the original survey, you can see the data.
If you were going to do an alcohol study, would you use this product?
If you're starting from scratch, yes.
Yeah.
If you're going out there trying to find the alcohols, mapping them, but if you're doing revisitation, I'd probably do a collector with related tables and doing an individual inspection kind of process.
Why do you say that, Justin? What's the advantage?
You can have the points and you can just add on. So this one is this year, and then a new inspection the following year, and you can have a growing related table, a one-to-many basically. While this is primarily, without getting into the Excel forms and stuff, it's a one-to-one.
Okay. So every time you go out and take a survey, it's kind of creating another point?
Yep, creating a new feature.
Gotcha.
But Collector has the ability to add on to that existing.
So you could have multiple inspection reports on tied to the.
Presentation will be, and also the recording.